Josh Roundtable, episode number 17. Today we have quite the amount of guests as we're going to be going through what we're calling a generational discussion. So mom and or dad got son and or daughter into Rush, or perhaps the other way around. I don't know yet. I haven't heard their stories. So we're going to have everyone introduce themselves first. Sarah and Diana can go first. If you guys want to just tell us, you know, perhaps your favorite Rush song, favorite album, couple shows you've been to, you know, keep it short and sweet, but just to give us a little introduction of yourselves.
Okay. I'm Diana. My favorite Rush songs are, a couple of them are Presto and A Farewell to Kings, which are also albums. And my favorite album right now is Snakes and Arrows. I've been to 22 Rush concerts. Wow. And I am the mother of three Rush fans, Angie, and Sarah.
And I'm Sarah. My favorite Rush songs are The Pass and Nobody's Hero. My favorite Rush album is Hold Your Fire, and I've seen Rush 10 times.
That's a lot. Awesome.
That is a lot. All right, so Heather and Rian.
I'm Rian, this is Heather, obviously. My favorite album is probably Permanent Waves, and my favorite song is actually off of the album, it's Natural Science.
Oh, I love it.
Nice.
It's strong all the way through. I love every little bit of it. It's just the best ever. I've been to zero show. I became a fan like half a year after they stopped touring.
Sorry.
Hi, Mom. My favorite song is kind of cheesy because it's Blind White, which is like a super popular song. My favorite album is Permanent Waves. And I didn't go to any Rush concert. I was supposed to go once with a boyfriend, but we broke up. So and then before that, I was like having children and
I think it was the R30.
Yeah.
Once this need to go out.
And you are 13, correct?
Yep.
That is awesome. That is
really. Ready, we're next.
All right. So we'll go to Kira and Mom and Dad.
Okay, my name is Darren, Kira's dad, and my favorite song, of course, there's a lot of them. One of the ones I really like right now is Between the Wheels, kind of shows what we're going through right now. Favorite album, that's hard to say, but used to be a lot of the older stuff, but now it's probably from Signals through Hold Your Fire, that period. Then a 10 Rush concert, starting with Hemispheres, and then all the way up to the latest one. And I used to play a lot of Rush's older stuff up to 2112 on my bass guitar. All the world's a stage. Play a lot of that on bass.
Awesome. Huh?
It's your turn.
Okay. My favorite album, of course, I don't really have a clear favorite, you know, because that's probably a lot of you can say that, right? But today I'm going with Roll the Bones.
Yes.
and I actually was going to say Power Windows, but I really like Rush's instrumentals. And so starting with Roll the Bones and forward and probably backwards, I don't know. One year I put every instrumental on my iPod that I took to the gym. So that's like my, you know, zone out workout.
Yeah.
playlist. I do have another playlist that has songs with words, but you know, so we're gonna go with instrumentals. Where's My Thing, you know, started it. And then yeah, so I have seen 6 different Rush concerts, and whereas Darren was going in between all the years between teenagerhood and later adulthood, I didn't do that. I just skipped the whole middle part. And did I answer them all?
Yeah, that's a good
name. Name. I don't think we got your name.
Samantha. Darren. Okay. And Samantha, like on Bewitched.
All right, and Kira, we are, we already know. We already know Kira, so
she doesn't get to talk.
let's just go through a song that you guys are currently hooked on, and if there's not a specific song you're hooked on, just give a shout out to kind of a deeper song that perhaps, you know, someone who hasn't heard it in a while may hear that you're discussing it and would want to throw it on, or perhaps a song that some maybe the casual fan has never heard. So so Sarah and Diana, we'll start with you guys.
Okay. Right now I've been listening to Working Them Angels from Snakes and Arrows, and partly because I've been rereading Neil's book, Traveling Music, and the book highlights that song and goes through just like different eras in Neil's life and the music that influenced him at that time. And so when I listen to it, when I read the book, it just kind of makes me do the same thing.
Awesome. I've been really into Dreamline because I've been traveling a lot, and it just kind of makes me want to travel.
Bad time to do that.
Yeah. Yeah.
This probably won't get posted for another month, but it's March 23rd and coronavirus is running wild. All right, Heather and Rian.
A song that I'm hooked on right now is probably The Body Electric. That is just,
yeah, I love that song.
Cool. I love the intro with just the drums and the bass. Just
awesome.
Did you pick a
song for right now?
Yeah.
Okay, I'm gonna say that.
All right, sorry. Did Heather? Heather, did you go?
No, not yet.
Okay, sorry. Yeah, go ahead.
So Entree New is the one that I'm hooked on right now, and most of the songs that I get hooked on are because of this guy who's sitting next to me. Some of them I had never even heard, and he's giving me a good Rush education for sure.
I think he's double.
That's awesome.
173.
That's so cool. Darren and Samantha and Kira. Kira, you can talk this time. So
okay, fine, I'll speak. Okay, so this is a song I've been hooked on / want to give a shout out to. It's actually both, and that would be Red Tide from Presto. My Presto kick has continued, but Red Tide really reflects what's going on right now, and it's one of those other themes that Neil wrote that's kind of political, that is really relevant to today. So I've been listening to that a lot this week. And
nature has some new plague to run in our streets.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yep.
All right, now you guys can say what's your favorite song this week. Go Mom.
That was very well thought out. I don't know, I have a little problem, and that is that once I got married to Darren, he would buy the Rush albums and play them all the time, and I never looked at the covers. So I know them all by sound, but I don't know the names for most of that last 20 years. Kind of weird, I know. So I'm going back to one of the albums that I did read the cover of a lot before Kira came into the picture. Who has time for that after you have kids, right? So I'm going with Roll the Bones, Bravado.
Oh,
it just makes me feel kind of chilled out, sort of, when my brain's going, woo.
All right, Dad.
Lean in, Daddy.
I have a lot of them.
Lean in, Daddy.
Yeah, I am. I was on a bike ride today, and I was thinking, Heather, I'm sorry, what's your son? What's your name, young man?
Rian.
Rian? No, I mean, The Body Electric is such an unusual song, and I really like the, it's a very difficult song for bass and guitar. Very unusual song for Rush. I really like the solo that they have in that song because it's just, it's fantastic. So, I mean, right now I'd say that's one of my favorites.
Okay, cool. Kate.
All right, I had to go on mute because I thought my cat was gonna start yelling, but she didn't. She tends to do that. I was listening to Red Barchetta today, and I hit repeat several times. So, shout out to that.
Alex? Not Lifeson?
Yep. Never get old.
But currently I'm hooked on Everyday Glory. I'm sure a lot of people are at the moment because I think the final verse is just really powerful stuff, and it really kind of reflects our situation as a, you know, on a worldwide phenomenon, really, with this coronavirus. You know, like we know that we're the, I'm messing up the lyric. Though we live in trying times, we're the ones that have to shine. You know the lyrics.
You know. Alex, good together.
Alex hasn't been on in a few episodes. He's all out.
Yeah,
of
it has been a while.
Alex, not like.
Yeah. No. I agree with you. For me, it's Vapor Trail. from Vapor Trails.
Almost title track.
Almost title track. Yeah, I've been hooked on that one lately. Yeah, I mean, for me, I listen to a lot of Rush in my car, and again, I'm not really going anywhere because I'm not supposed to, so right. I haven't been listening to much for anything, but I've had Vapor Trails stuck in my head all day, so shout out to that song. All right, so let's get into our stories, our family-related stories, why, you know, mom and or dad got son and or daughter or vice versa into Rush, and any stories, you know, you guys want to talk about. So we'll start with Sarah and Diana.
Okay, so I had a brother who was 7 years older, and he introduced me to Rush when I was about 12 years old. He handed me his 2112 album one day and said, you need to listen to this. And I did. And he took me to my first Rush concert in 1984. It was Grace Under Pressure. And then I just became a huge Rush fan. By the time I graduated from high school, they were my favorite band, listened to them all the time. Had three kids, just kept listening, and always felt really lucky because none of my kids ever complained about it. Nobody ever said, Mom, turn that off, or can you please turn it down? They just listened. And then on the other hand, I kind of thought, well, why would they complain? Because it's Rush.
My earliest memory is driving around in the car listening to Test for Echo, and I would have been about 3 years old when Test for Echo came out. But Rush was always just part of our lives.
Yeah, it was always part of our lives and always like a really big deal. We always celebrated everything Rush was like a big deal. So if a new CD or a new DVD came out, it was Rush Awareness Day. And so we're probably going to have Canadian bacon pizza for dinner or maybe a maple bar for dessert. Yeah. And if we had concert tickets.
When we went to concerts for an entire month before the concert, it was Rush Awareness Month, so we would only listen to Rush. The day of the concert was Rush Awareness Day.
Again.
And we imposed that on our friends and our coworkers or, you know, whoever we were with.
No radio, just Rush. Yeah. And all Rush. We had a couple years, we had Rush-themed Christmas cards.
We had a bird named Vitor, and my brother's name is Getty.
Yeah.
So it's just like, well, it was always part of our lives.
And we went to a lot of concerts.
Your brother's name is Getty?
Yeah.
It is.
That so
is
her son, my brother. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, I picked that out sitting on my bedroom floor listening to that 2112 album, and I thought, if I ever have a son, I'm going to name him Getty. Just had to find the right guy to agree to it.
Yeah.
So, yeah, we went to a lot of concerts. My oldest daughter saw her first Rush concert when she was 18 months old.
Didn't she stand up when Dreamland played?
Yeah, we'd been listening to Roll the Bones nonstop, and they came out and they played Dreamland. It was the seventh song in their set, and she'd just been kind of hanging out on a blanket, and all of a sudden they started that song, and she stood up and started dancing like, you know, how little kids do.
Not me.
Really cute.
My sister.
So we've just gone to a lot of concerts, and I think for the kids, because Rush always had new material that whole time, and they got to go see them. So when they started making their own choices, it was new music, and it was like a real band that was still relevant, and they could still go see them. And so they just all became Rush fans in their own right.
Yeah. In 2012, every 21st day of the month, we had Rush Awareness Day because it was 2112 Day.
Yeah.
So we got to have 12 Rush Awareness Days for an entire year. It was really fun.
Right. We're waiting for the year 21.
Yeah. Yeah. and we went to R40 together as a family.
Sarah and I went and met Getty Lee.
Yeah. We flew to San Francisco. We're from Seattle. We flew to San Francisco last year to meet Getty Lee. And then me and my sister and brother and mom went and met him in Seattle. And it was really fun because Getty got to meet Getty.
Yeah. Getty and Getty together at last.
Yeah.
That's what I always said.
And then we've continued to celebrate Rush because we do Neil Peart-inspired National Park road trips. So Neil Peart went to all the national parks, and to kind of fill the void of not being able to go to Rush concerts anymore, we are going around and visiting all the national parks just like Neil did. And we do the things that Neil talked about, like what he did. Like, we stay in the same places that he stayed. So for example, you know, he stayed at the, what's the cabin on the rim of the Grand Canyon?
The Rim Cabin.
Yeah, the Rim Cabin. So we stayed there, and we're pretty sure we stayed in the same cabin as him, you know, because there's only 8 of them. So chances are high. But we document everything on our website and our Instagram, and it's all like Rush inspired. Well, it's Neil Peart inspired, but the entire trips are centered around Rush.
Yeah.
People ask us what we talk about on our road trips, because they're typically like 4,000 miles. And they're like, what do you do? What do you talk about? And we mostly just talk about Rush.
Yeah. Talk about Rush. Listen to Rush.
Mm-hmm. You guys want to give the handle for your page for people to follow you?
Oh, for our Instagram is official_NP, like Neil Peart Tour.
Yeah, Neil Peart National Park. And then our website is nptour.net.
That's awesome. That's really cool. Like, that's a really cool story. We'll discuss at length after everyone, you know, tells their stories. We'll discuss as a group. But
this is our shirt for our most recent tour that got canceled because of the coronavirus.
Yeah.
So that's what we're wearing.
Yeah. Official MP tour is officially quarantined.
Yeah.
That's fantastic. Do you guys have anything else you wanna say, or? Guys, good?
We're good.
All right. Yeah. Awesome. That's fantastic. Heather and Rian, why don't you guys go ahead, take the floor.
Yeah. So we're officially on a national park tour right now. We're actually right outside the Grand Canyon. So
we did. Are you? That's so cool.
We're staying away from everyone. And actually, it was on. So Rian and I take a ton of trips together, and it was actually on one of our trips to Breckenridge going skiing, where Rian's been a little rocker for a long time. He plays the bass and the guitar, and we were driving back to our lodge, and I was like, oh, you want to hear a really cool band? And I believe it was Limelight that was on, and I like cranked it up for him, and he was like, yeah, that's really good. And then I went and started playing more Rush songs for him, and he was hooked. I had no idea the extent of what this would turn into, because all we've listened to in the car since we've been traveling, we're from Chicago, but we started out in LA to do this road trip. So yeah, he was hooked. And then, yeah, that's you take it from there. He knows everything there is to know about Rush. Yeah. Yeah. Like it scares me. And then to try to make up for the fact that he hadn't been to any Rush concerts, and he was just devastated, you know, with Neil's passing. I mean, it was horrible. But we did go and do the book signing of the Big Beautiful Book of Bass. So he did get to meet Geddy Lee. So that was super cool. 4 hours of waiting, but it was well worth it. So talk about your passion.
Yeah, well, you didn't mention the dates.
Oh, so sorry.
I must. So she first played for me April 2016. And then I started listening to it, like, you know, in little parts. And then I think it was in, and I was a fan then, but the time where I really became like a fanatic, I should say. Late July, early August of 2017. That's when I just listened. I listened to the Chronicles album a lot, the compilation album, and I got really into it.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. He was talking to people in line at the book signing, and they were like blown away by how much Rush knowledge he had. But he you want to talk about when you?
Yeah, so I was next in line for Geddy Lee, and then I froze. I didn't say anything because I was too nervous.
He was too nervous, but he did get his to meet him, right? Yeah. Yeah.
I think the only thing I said was hi. So Geddy Lee wrote in the book, hi, Rian, and then signed it. Something like that.
He said it's his biggest regret. We're trying to get over it now by not saying anything to Geddy. And then hopefully, I haven't heard anything. I haven't checked because we've been out, but we were going to go to the tribute in Toronto that is supposed to be happening in May for Neil. That was supposed to be our next road trip, but I haven't seen any updates yet, so hopefully, fingers crossed, it's still happening.
Yeah,
Do you want to talk about any?
Yeah, probably wait and see. I haven't heard any either. But yeah.
We just one more thing. When we flew into LA, completely Cloroxed, but we did take a trip to Neil Peart's house. So we took some pictures of Rian like standing in front of his house.
Like his meeting?
Yeah.
That's so cool.
Yeah, and it wasn't like all fun. I mean, like I kind of like honored him and stuff.
Yeah.
Awesome. You guys have anything else you want to add, or are you guys good?
No, we're good.
Fantastic. Kira and Mom and Dad.
Oh, this is gonna be fun.
You want me to go first, Sam?
Yeah. Okay.
Okay, so my we had a neighbor who a guy named Joe Karzewski who bought their first album. He's like, hey, this is a great band, blah, 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 blah. And one of my brothers, I think, went to the 2112 tour at the West Palm Beach Auditorium. So one of my brothers bought 2112. So I think he bought All the World's a Stage, and I really got hooked right away. I was listening to Kiss and Aerosmith. Those were the big bands I was into. I really became a big Rush fan. I like Paul McCartney a lot. The Wings stuff. I was into grew up listening to the Beatles and all that. But my first Rush concert was Hemispheres, and my brother Tierney took me and another brother, and I liked what was cool about that concert. It was kind of like the old Rush, the heavy metal type of Rush. They played all 21, they pretty much played all the world's stage, and they played a lot of Farewell to Kings. They played the whole first side of Hemispheres. So that was cool because that ended come Permanent Waves, which was different. So then I saw Permanent Waves. I got a good friend who's into guitar. We used to play their stuff. You know, I learned to play a lot of their stuff from All the World's a Stage on bass. I learned to play Free Will. I was taking bass lessons. I got really good. Free Will was tough, but I got to a certain point where I could play that. But then there was some of the stuff like YYZ and all that I couldn't play because it was just too advanced. I had to keep playing to get there. But anyways, you know, as far as the Moving Pictures tour, that was the one where I and Samantha didn't know each other, but we both got tear gassed.
And that story is coming up in full soon.
So, honey, why don't you go and then we'll do our version of the tear gas story.
Did you already say every song you remember?
Well, again, it was a lot of the
stuff. We have a list of what we're
that was on All the World's Stage. It was pretty much the whole first side of the album. I played all 2112, which isn't, if you really practice, you can learn that. It's not that hard. You play a lot of scales and stuff. You could pick that stuff up. Yeah, again, it was a lot of stuff on All the World's Stage. Go ahead, honey.
Okay, so I became a fan kind of indirectly. See, what happened was I was 16, and I had been to two concerts with friends. And the one I had just gone to was Journey. I was a Journey lover boy fan. That was my top two right then. And we had such a good time. A 16-year-old did that tour that we're like, we have to go to another concert immediately. So we went to the place, the ticket place, the very next day. This is pre-internet, in case no one realizes that.
Yeah.
no internet, no online. You had to go to the place. So we walk in, and we're going to just go to the absolute very next one that there is that we know the band. And it was Rush. So I go there with my boyfriend, his twin brother, a couple other friends. And Moving Pictures. And so when I watched Getty run around that stage recreating their music as close as possible to, you know, what it sounded like in the studio, because back then, you know, it was, you know, whereas it used to be there wasn't as much manipulation of music in, say, the 40s, 50s, 60s, you know, getting to the 70s, 80s, 90s, there was a lot of manipulation of the music after the studio album was recorded. You know, some bands couldn't reproduce their music at all on stage. It sounded ridiculous. Like, mm-hmm. I heard the Cars was like that. I'm not sure. I didn't ever hear it myself. But Rush sounded so good on stage. I was so impressed. I mean, I just, like, as obviously I haven't forgotten it, and that was 43 years ago. No, wait, I can't add. Hold on a second. Wait, what's I'm 54, so when is that's almost 40 years.
Yeah.
So, 1981, yeah. So that's like, yeah. So that's how I became a fan.
So now it's time for the famed tear gas story.
No.
Okay, never mind.
So, because the tear gas story is just holds its own, so I have to tell more about me and Darren and Rush, because I think it's interesting, you know, what happens when you lean forward, honey, and disappeared. you know, when you meet a guy and you want to have something in common with him so that you have a reason to talk to him, you know, we were in a group of friends. And so, and he played bass, and my brother played bass, and they both liked more of the rock, jazz. My brother was his rock progressive, but Darren was into the rock, jazz side, and I was in some rock, more pop. So when I found out that he was a bass player, you know, we started talking about that, and then he started talking about Rush, and that, so that was like the only band that we listened to in common between him and me. Probably not the only one, but, you know, they were so prominent at the time.
Right.
You know, all those years, we met in 1990, you know, so through our entire marriage, Rush has been like this one common thread that's gone through the whole thing with every album. And then after 2000, after everything happened to Neil, he bought a bunch of concert DVDs, and we just watched those to death, you know, and that's actually how Kira got started getting exposed, you know, and then when that last concert came, you know, she was old enough to go with us, and she'd been to a couple concerts. But we had to get her into some like real music because the first two concerts were the Jonas Brothers.
Oh God, I was 12.
She's 12 and they're 14. So this was a big deal. I mean, I never went to a concert with my parents. Are you kidding? There was no commonality whatsoever. Right. I mean, there was, so.
I want you guys to tell the tear gas story, but before that, I just wanted to say that, like, my very first memory that I have personally is watching the Rush and Rio tour DVD with them when I was, like, 6 or 7.
So enthralling.
And then one of my other favorite memories other than the concert is when we were painting my room when I was 9, and we were listening to and dancing to Roll the Bones, the album. We were, like, rapping to Roll the Bones, and it was really funny, little 9-year-old me. But... yeah, tear gas story time.
Honey, why don't I go first?
Showtime.
Actually, I just got to say something. So the first Rush concert, Hemispheres, was, I can still remember, the band that opened for him was a band called UFO. What a great name for a heavy metal band. The tickets were $5.50.
Yeah.
Albums used to be $5. Okay, so when I went to see Permanent Waves, the tickets doubled to 11. And Gene Simmons, I can remember, he was furious because, you know, he's blaming Carter, the oil embargo, blah, 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 whatever. So, tear gas story. So, I went with a
couple of my
brothers.
Maybe after the virus is done, they'll bring the prices back down for a while.
Yeah. So, we go to the concert. We get there early. We're at the gate. And we're like, why isn't the gate open? You know?
What time was it by then?
It was like, I don't know, 6:45, whenever the concert was supposed to start.
Oh, no, it was much closer to 8.
Okay, whatever. So, just let me tell my story. So, anyways, there's a cop with his hand on his baton, and we're like, what's going on? Why isn't the gate open? He says, just get your friends. When we open the gate, just get your friends and get inside as soon as possible. We're like, okay. So we heard like one of the roadies hit a guitar, tune up one of the guitars, and then people behind us were yelling, 1, 2, 3, 4, open up the effing door, 5, 6, 7, 8, open up the effing gate. And the cops were like, behind the gate, were like, wow. I mean, they looked scared. Like, okay, we're going to hit somebody. So they open the gate. We run in. Soon after we run in and we sit down, I notice my nose starts burning. Now, I was wearing hard lenses at the time. They protected my eyes from my eyes getting burning. But a couple of my brothers, their eyes were burning. Their noses were burning. Like, what's going on? And one of my brothers says, that's tear gas. So it was pretty freaky. And so we were up front, but after the concert, like a couple days later, I talked to one of the kids at school, and he says they were people climbing the gates, and cops were hitting them and this and that. And then I found out the reason why the
maybe
gate...
Maybe save that for the very end.
Well, the gate opened late because this was the second leg of the Moving Pictures tour, and Neil supposedly had missed his flight or something. He was in the Bahamas or whatever when he was sailing, and he came in late. Somebody saw him, a helicopter, fly by one of the doors at the Hollywood Sportatorium, and a guy get out looking like Neil Peart and running in. So that's what we found out. That was crazy. Go ahead, honey.
What's your side of the story?
Oh, by the way, Rian, don't feel bad about the Hi Rian thing. I'm sure that would have happened to most of us. I've had it happen to me with a different celebrity. and I was 50. Okay, so yeah, so when I was at the Moving Pictures concert, we were towards the back of the crowd, the far back of the crowd. So you had everybody crowded around the gates. And usually they open it early because they want to sell drinks and t-shirts and all that stuff. So there's this gate surrounding the property, and the Hollywood Sportatorium was kind of notorious because there's a lot of naughtiness going on there, and it wasn't a great venue. I mean, it just was kind of rickety, you know, and I was a kind of a goody two-shoes, so I would walk around there and get propositioned and be like, what, you know? Mm-hmm. So anyway, so we're standing out there in this big crowd of people because, you know, the parking lot's full, everyone's there. Usually the gates are open by like an hour before. It's almost 8 o'clock, which is supposed to be showtime, and the gates are not open yet. And this is the thing, if they would have just announced what was going on, if they would have just said, the band's not here yet, that would have been all they had to say to calm down the crowd, and everybody would have just like, okay, let's just sit here and wait. But no, they didn't tell us anything. Mm-hmm. Now, I was only 16. I wasn't out there causing trouble. And I believe my boyfriend and his, I think they were all 16, 17. Mm-hmm. So, you know, we were just like, what's going on? And, you know, since we were in the back of the crowd, mm-hmm. when they shot the tear gas off the first time, you know, you see this cloud of mist going over you. And I didn't know anything. I wasn't sure what to do. So I didn't start running until I was already burning. And so I'm running back towards the car, and, you know, and it gets worse and worse. And your eyes are burning, your nose, your mouth, your lungs, everything, like the soft tissue all around this part is all burning. And pretty soon I couldn't see anymore. So then wow. At that point, I just fell on the ground. I could barely breathe. Jeez. We were far back towards cars by this point. So I think I was probably out of most of it, but I thought I was going to die.
Wow.
I mean, you know, I'm like, does tear gas kill people? I didn't know anything, you know? So, you know, we sit down, we wait, you know, it starts to subside, and then we get back up and we see people are going back towards the gate. And I think the outer gate must have been open. So we kind of, instead of being towards the back of the crowd, this time we were like right up to the gate, and we managed to get to the gate, to the opening, mm-hmm. and we went through. And then just as we went through that gate, and it's like a 50, 100 foot
yeah.
run to the yeah. actual building. I don't right. remember how far, but
50, 100 feet.
Yeah. So my boyfriend and I were in the same shirt. It was a jersey with the raglan sleeve. So, you know, it was very distinctive. And so we passed through the gate. We're headed towards the building. They shoot off the tear gas again. And so just as I'm getting to the door of the main building is when the mist descends again, and I can't breathe and I can't see anything. And so just as I shut my eyes, I made it through the door. And the first person I ran into with my hand out like this, I'm like, because I can't see anything. The first person I run to is my boyfriend, because I can feel the shirt. I know it's the same one I have on.
Wow.
So, wow. It was like, I mean, like I thought I was this close to death. You know, I mean, it hurt that bad that you don't really know if you're going to live after that day. But Rush came on, and they were very apologetic. I mean, apologetic. Like, they kept apologizing because, of course, they would have never wanted this to happen to the fans mm-hmm. who are paying for their livelihood, mm-hmm. you know. And yeah. It was just a crazy, stupid. They just didn't handle it well. It's like, no. What are these people? There's a police. They're supposed to know how to do crowd control, right?
Yeah.
So, but the concert, like I said, it was amazing. You know, yeah. how Alex and Getty and Neil, you know, worked so hard to reproduce that music to sound just about exactly like it sounds on the album. And that was true for every concert we saw. Yeah. Would you say, mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'd say the only other band that compares with them live would be The Who. And I got to see The Who and Tangerine Bowl, and like 50 feet from the stage, and we're almost getting crushed, and The Who was out of this world. But they had that reputation. So I would say The Who, The Rush, and Who were on the same level. Those are the two best live bands I ever saw.
Well, that's pretty much it. But I don't know if you guys remember when we went to the Clockwork Angel store together. Well, my uncle was there too. He's also a Rush fan. He couldn't mm-hmm. be here.
Yeah.
But my uncle Andy, his younger brother. He has seven brothers. He has seven siblings, yeah. So it's a big
yeah.
family.
Yeah. Oh yeah, we went with the brothers to concerts yeah. when, you know, in the 2000s. We were older fans. But oh, and you go to a Rush concert, we would see his students there.
Yes, because I'm an English teacher.
Yeah, his students would
I would
be
see
there.
Some of my students there.
Parents with their kids, older people, every age group. It was like, where do you ever see that in
a concert? We had an AAP U.S. government teacher who's a huge Rush fan, and he first saw him 2112, and he, Mr. Hall, and he would go to their concerts, and I'd see him there and a couple of my students, and they're like, you know, it was pretty interesting.
Oh, and when he passed away, the students did a memorial, and they had Darren make a Rush playlist for what Mr. Hall liked. Mm-hmm. Oh, it was sweet.
Well, when we went to Clockwork Angels tour, just like, I loved it, of course. Most of the time, if like, I go back on the computer and I find the videos I took on my little digital camera when I was 18, you can hear me literally screaming. Mm-hmm. It does not sound cute, but I loved it. But one of my favorite parts of like the whole concert is when the Garden comes on. And so I had, actually, Uncle Andy was like right to my left, I think. And so, but we had like our arms linked in each other and we're like swaying and singing.
Kumbaya.
And I was crying, like I'm crying and singing. My like glitter makeup is going down my eyes. Yeah. And it was just like the most like surreal moment. That is the best concert experience I've ever had. Nothing will ever compare with that with you and mom.
Thanks, girl.
But yeah, that was pretty, this is pretty amazing. So we're a big old Rush family. Mm-hmm. That's our story. There we go. That was
14 minutes.
That's
ago.
Great. That's I mean, just for the sake of time, I'll just tell my quick story real quick. I actually got my mother into Rush. My mother's, I think, 60. So I went to my first Rush show on the Time Machine Tour in 2010 without her, unfortunately. And then I saw that I got her into them, and we went to see them at Madison Square Garden after that. Cool. And she was hooked since, and we saw four more shows after that. Three on Clockwork Angels in New Jersey, Connecticut, and New York. And then we saw them on R40 in New Jersey. But just a quick funny story, or two funny stories from Clockwork Angels at Saratoga Performing Arts Center in Saratoga, New York. During Territories, the lyrics spinning around and around, we started spinning around and around during that. And during the Spirit of Radio, we decided that it would be fun to go back-to-back like Alex and Getty as they came out to center stage. Leading up to the solo, so we were doing that as well. So I just wanted to share that. Unfortunately, she couldn't be here tonight. She's probably asleep. She's an early bird. But Alex or Kate, I mean, do you guys have any stories quickly you want to share before we discuss with the group, you know, in terms of stories with family members or anything like that, parents?
Well,
if not, it's okay. But what's that?
Quickly, I'll touch on the fact that I have a Rush marriage. My husband and I actually met in a Rush chat room in 2008. And we've been married for 7 years now. So, and like you guys were saying, like Rush is literally the only thing we have in common. But I mean, we've made it this far. So I guess it's good.
My wife hates Rush. So that's that. So. We have other things in common, but it's just not Rush. Alex?
I discovered Rush at a pretty young age, and then my mom was like, oh, wait, that's Rush. I think you might actually like them. And then she sort of, like, slowly introduced me to some of the older Rush material, and then with my very first Rush show, we actually went together. It was during the Snakes and Arrows tour. That was a lot of fun. And they opened with Limelight, which is my mom's favorite song ever, so...
I remember that.
Yeah, that was a lot of fun.
Saw that.
And awesome. My parents do like Rush as well. I've been to concerts with them. My mom and I actually have matching Presto tattoos.
Wow.
I have three Rush tattoos. I would show you this one. It's the Starman, but I'm wearing a sweatshirt. So, yeah. We're a Rush family.
That's awesome. So, I mean, real quick, I'd say let's open it up for a quick discussion on these stories that you guys have shared with us. I mean, anything that anybody want to discuss about anybody's stories that they've shared?
Mm-hmm.
I think Ryan's wishing he was a little bit older so he could date the older rock fans. You just can't find people the same age with the same
Rush. Yeah. Right? Oh, don't give up, though. A lot of Darren students don't like the newer music. They like the older stuff. So you're going to find somebody that digs it.
Yeah, you will. As a matter of fact, because I get these students that wear, you know, I haven't seen these students wear a Rush t-shirt, but AC/DC or Smith. Now, some of them don't even, I ask them, do you listen to that band? No, I just like the shirt. You know? And then there's other kids that say, well, you know, one kid said to me, well, everything from the 90s afterward is gay. And I'm like, come on. I said, there's good bands. He's like, no, it's the, you know, the older bands. I'm like, okay. Yeah,
he teaches high school, so it's a high school band.
I think Ryan
She's going to probably be too young for Ryan, but I have a granddaughter on the way, and I've already cleared it with her mother that she's okay to be a Rush fan.
Yes!
There you go. I just think it's crazy that 13-year-old Ryan has gotten mom into Rush. I just think that's fantastic. You know, I mean, I think that's just crazy. And, you know, the tear gas story that you guys shared, I mean, that's insane as well.
yeah,
I mean, it's...
That was a good one.
Yeah, I
still remember the pain.
I don't have any stories that can top that. And you guys, Sarah and Diana, I mean, that what you're doing is well, what you're doing. I didn't mean the Rush on there, but...
But you did that.
But I did, yeah, that was not on purpose. But I mean, that's seriously awesome as well. I mean, I just think that's super cool that you guys have that connection, that you guys do that as well.
Yeah, we started it 3 years ago, actually. But, and it was after I got out of college when I started, you know, wanting to go to the parks. And, you know, my mom has read Neil's books about 1,000 times. And I've read them too, but she's read them a lot. And I remember we were planning a trip for my graduation. And we were kind of talking about it. And I said, well, I want to go to all these national parks. And my mom said, Neil Peart went to all the national parks. And I said, then I think we should. And then just, that's like how it started. And we just started.
Do you guys ride motorcycles too there? Or no.
Oh,
okay.
Boy, I have
to
say, I added this too. Hold on.
Okay.
I don't think I can. Try to kill your background. Yeah, just.
Well, my screensaver, he changes everything. Like at work, I have double monitors and they both say Rush on it. So he went in and like changed my monitors. Yeah, and now my background on my iPhone is the Snakes and Arrows album cover. So I literally.
And I got the gold guy from Curse of Steel on mine.
Oh, nice. Cool.
Nice.
The necromancer.
Well, young Ryan, I love how big of a fan you are and that you're so, you know, young, and you obviously didn't discover Rush until after they stopped touring, but that you know so much knowledge. And actually, I have to say that even though they've retired, that I'm actually a bigger fan now than I have ever been, especially now that I've joined this page. And ever since, you know, Neil's passing, I've just been rereading all of his books, like, constantly and listening to Rush more. But I just love how you're carrying the torch, my man. It's awesome.
Oh yeah, it's great to be able to share stuff, you know, with people that can appreciate it. You know, like, well, we also read a couple of Neil's books, Ghost Rider and whatever came after that.
Traveling Music.
Thank you. Yeah, and with Ghost Rider, now my mom died in 2000, and so that's only, what, a year and 2 years after his wife and daughter died. So I read it, you know, close to that loss, and so I really related to everything he said. Like, you can really feel it just as he felt it, because you're there, right there. Somebody that has been a long time since they lost a relative, like 10-15 years, you're not gonna feel it the same way, because when his brother read it, he was like, you know, I'm like, oh no, I understood everything, because you're there in the same place.
Mm-hmm. So the first time I read Ghost Rider, I'd never lost anybody that close to me, and it just really was, just struck me at how difficult that was. And there were so many times I just have to set the book down and cry. It just did not stop, you know. I grew up in a family where you more like have to just move on. And so months down the road, and it was still so devastating, and it was it really made an impression on me. And my brother passed away about 5 years ago, and I was afraid to pick it up. I didn't know if I could read it again, but I did. I did manage to get through it. But it really changed my perspective. It's a really good book.
Yeah. Absolutely. Yeah, I'm currently reading it as well myself. But that being said, going to wrap up episode 17 here. Thank you all for joining us and for sharing your stories and you know, your generational story, so to speak. we hope that you enjoyed this unique video that we did for you and those watching. And if you have any stories, family-related stories that you guys want to share in the comments for those that are watching this video, feel free, please do so. And thank you for watching. Take care, everyone.